friends, and as we continue to celebrate the life more abundant indeed, our speaker this morning is here to share with us his thoughts on the power of oneness. In another of his usual intriguing, thought-provoking, and informative messages, please help me welcome to the podium our own Reverend Michael Reckord.
Thank you, Jennifer. You left out funny. Good morning, friends. At the Temple of Light Center for Spiritual Living, and greetings too to those listening by the internet. For the benefit of the latter, I can report that it's a lovely summery morning in sunny Jamaica. I can see from the podium green trees and multicolored flowers. I see pink and I see white and I see red and I see some yellow butterflies and I see some brownish grass. We have not been getting as much rain as we would like. I also see quite a bit of blue sky and some white clouds out there. This is a beautiful and an abundant land. The church is focusing this month, as you heard, on prosperity. And I continue on that theme, looking specifically at the connection between prosperity or abundance and oneness. The title of the talk is Reverend John's Banana. I thought you'd like that one. When I told that title to Reverend Sonia yesterday, she wanted to know if the banana was a big Gros Michel, or a medium-sized Lacatan, or a tiny, shiny banana. Sean calls them bumpy banana. Let me tell you the story behind the title, so there won't be any misunderstanding about what I'm talking about. The story demonstrates the spiritual connection that we humans have. I usually have an orange in the mornings at about 10:30. That's my breakfast. But a couple of Saturdays ago at 9:30, as I was leaving home for our weekly ministers' meeting here, I realized we had run out of oranges. I thought to myself, I wish there was a banana. But I had to leave home without either fruit. We had run out of bananas as well. Now, these ministers' meetings have been taking place for about 15 years. And in all that time, Reverend John has never bought me anything edible to eat. He and Reverend Sonia usually carry coffee, but they know I don't drink coffee, and I take my banana, my orange. So that morning, I was amazed when Reverend John gave Reverends Anne and Sonia two huge, sweet-looking muffins, which I don't eat, he knows, and handed me a banana. When I told him I had wished for a banana as I was leaving home, he revealed that he had picked up the two muffins for the ladies and was actually at his car, about to get in to come here, when it occurred to him that he should also take something for me. So just about the time that I was making my wish for a banana, he went back inside and he got the banana. That thought transference that occurred between Reverend John and me was not the first one. I've told the story before from this podium, how once I was writing an article and I needed a particular word that I was just for the article. And I thought to myself, you know, Reverend John would know that word. Within 2 minutes, the phone rang. It was Reverend John calling on another matter completely. And he did know the word. So I got it for my article. I've also had phone calls as I was thinking about my wife, my sisters, my daughter, my friends, and even acquaintances. And every one of you has a similar story. Probably everyone in the world. In fact, they probably have several similar stories, with sometimes the person appearing instead of phoning, you know. Not everyone has a phone. The only explanation for that is that human beings are connected to one another by thought. There's no other explanation. The apple only had to fall on Isaac Newton's head once, and he said, ah, there's something named gravity. In the textbook, The Science of Mind, Dr. Ernest Holmes, the founder of religious science, that's the name of our religion or philosophy or teaching or way of life, take your pick, explains that connection between humans or among humans this way. I quote, "We are surrounded by a universal mind that reacts to our thoughts," unquote. Try this quick exercise. Imagine yourself in a vast ocean of thought. In that ocean, every time you think, things move and manifest or disappear. That is exactly how your life works. Your thoughts make things happen. Thought is creative, says Dr. Holmes. In this program, right at the back, would you please turn to the back of your inside back cover, please? And would you read with me that section entitled "A New Way to Think," inside back cover? Together? "There is a power for good in the universe greater than you are, and you can use it. There is no question about the creativeness of thoughts. If any thought is creative, it must follow that all thought is creative. The law of mind is exact. The only question is, how are we going to use this creative power within us? Shall we use it constructively for a definite purpose, or shall we use it destructively merely because we do not understand it? Change the idea of a thing and you will change the thing. To learn how to live is to learn, think is to learn how to live." Dr. Ernest Holmes, founder of religious science. Thank you. Another luminary of religious science, which is also called science of mind, Raymond Charles Barker, explains the process a little further. I quote, "The law of cause and effect produces our subconscious desires," unquote. He's referring to the logical operation of the universe that we all know. Every effect, and effects are the things that we see about us and the events in our lives. Every effect has a cause. And our thoughts are causes, so they produce effects. Barker here is speaking specifically about our subconscious desires producing effects in our lives. Just to repeat what's the quote. "The law of cause and effects produces our subconscious desires." So he's speaking about our subconscious desires here. And he'd also agree that our conscious desires produce things too. But, he would say, not as readily. Did I hear somebody thinking, why not? Yes, yes, somebody over in that section over there. I'm getting it. I'm so glad you thought that, because it gives me a reason for a commercial break. On Thursday, I started a 4-class course called Science of Mind Fundamentals, in which we discuss 2 essays, Life is Consciousness and the Mental Equivalent. If you come to the classes, you'll get the answer to that question. Why not? Classes are Thursday. They last from 6 to 8. And as you heard, those born in July can come to 1 class free. End of commercial. Back to our regular programming. One reason I think Reverend John and I have a strong thought connection is that we started transcendental meditation together about 1980, some 36 years ago. And we've been teaching together for about 15 years. One current course that has been going on for 3.5 years is called Change Your Thinking, Change Your Life. And our students, as most of you know, are prison inmates. The visitors will be learning that perhaps for the first time. Every Tuesday we go to prison and we teach a class. To get to our class, we go through 10 iron doors and gates. Ironically, the last one, which lets us into the chapel, is the largest. Yes, the door to the building dedicated to worship is taller and wider and more solid than the gate at the front on Tower Street, which we walk through to get into the prison itself. That's just a regular sized door, but iron. I think there's a lesson there to be learned, but a lesson about separation, not oneness, which is my theme. I'm going to mention some of the, to my mind, unusual inmates I've encountered in the prison. As my escort on Tuesday, Mr. Fletcher and I were walking along, we got to talking about the many classes that are run in the prison, and there are a whole lot of them. And I asked if the prisoners were benefiting from them. Definitely, said Mr. Fletcher. And he pointed to one inmate who was just ahead of us. He was a Muslim, Mr. Fletcher said, who had been talking to Mr. Fletcher and told him how he had been involved in some really terrible things on the outside and how the classes that he had been attending in prison had changed his thinking. Many of our students tell similar stories. And Reverend John and I like to think that our classes are responsible for some, at least some, of the change. In our class now, though, the current one, is a fellow that we have not yet turned around. He keeps insisting that he is a thief. We ask him what he, and he says, I'm a thief. But he's very good with electronic equipment. And on Tuesday, he worked on a speaker box with a multiplicity of wires, and some of them covered, some of them bare, for about 30 minutes, so that the class could hear the documentary, The Secret, that Reverend John had brought for them to listen to. When this fellow is released, he'll have a choice between whether to continue stealing, which apparently is his destiny, he thinks, or to work with amplifiers, which he says he wants to do. His choice will be between belief, what he believes he is, and his desire to master amplifiers. And I know that many of you are faced with the same choice. You believe sincerely that your condition, the one that you're in now, is one thing, and you want that thing to be different. For example, many of you may believe that you are poor, and what you want is prosperity. Also in the class is an ex-soldier. He says he was in the JDF for 17 years and rose to the rank of sergeant major. He says that his time in prison is the worst period in his life and that Jesus is his only friend. After Tuesday's class, in another room of the educational center where we were, I saw an inmate at a desk marking some very, very complex math problems. I suspect you might find it a little problematic. A mathematician yourself, Bavar. He said he was a graduate of Shortwood Teachers College, and he taught math and science to inmates. In the recent CSEC math exam, he said, he had had 5 students with very good passes, and he was expecting 8 students to pass well next year. And he also wanted to send up some students for the CAPE advanced level math. What was a math and science teacher doing in the general penitentiary, I wondered to myself, when we need them so badly outside? Of course, the answer may be that they're needed even more in prison. And things are, in fact, in divine order. Maybe. Here's another reason. The inmate, that math whiz, wanted me to tell him about science of mind. And I started telling him about same, but I had to leave. The ward had come for us, and before I got very far. But I may see him again. People tend to stay in general penitentiary for quite a while. And if I can get him to accept science of mind principles, maybe he can teach them along with the math and science. The more inmates we can get accepting science of mind principles, the better off they and Jamaica will be. Then a month ago, I met a tall, good-looking fellow, well-spoken inmate. Something I said as we were talking, he interpreted as my being disrespectful, and he rather stiffly informed me that he had a master's degree. It wasn't the first I'd met there. More recently, we met Wayne, a cultured-looking man with a rich, modulated sort of voice. I wasn't surprised when a warder told me that Wayne had worked in radio and was quite famous. But I was surprised when Wayne told me that he had been the head boy of one of our top boys' high schools, traditional top. I will not name the school out of respect for certain people here. I'm talking about these inmates, folks, to say something quite simple. In the general penitentiary, you'll find many bright, well-educated inmates, along with many less bright ones with very little education. Some can't read or write. I see all their different crimes as having one thing in common. The men had a sense of lack and wanted more than they had, or thought they had. Raymond Charles Barker, mentioned earlier, said, I quote, "The moment you decide to live a richer life, your consciousness will devise the ways and means of your having it," unquote. I'd say that, generally speaking, the consciousness of those inmates devised unlawful ways of getting the prosperity they wanted. Not surprisingly, they got prison terms instead of prosperity. The spiritual lesson to be learned is that if we go against the law, spiritual or man-made, will suffer consequences we don't like. You mustn't hurt people in pursuit of what you want. That statement applies generally and also specifically with prosperity. Don't try to get prosperous in unlawful ways. And please note that I'm not referring to defining prosperity as only financial wealth. I mean general abundance in relationships, in opportunities, in material possessions, as well as money in the bank. Don't try to get relationships, for example, in ways that will hurt somebody. The argument I'm putting forward in this talk is simple and logical. We accept the premise that we are all part of an infinitely creative universal mind that reacts to our thoughts, right? That means we have a tool to create whatever we want, that mind. So if we think our world, macro or micro, is one of lack, we are mistaken. True, we may be experiencing lack, but the reason for that is that we are not making use of our tool of production, infinite creative mind. It's like having millions of dollars in the bank, but not knowing how to access it. So the question that you might now have is, how can you make maximum use of the infinite creative mind? In another talk, if I had another 20 minutes, I could give you many ways. But in the few minutes I have left, I'll quote a certain lawyer's answer to a question Jesus asked him. The lawyer said, in answer to Jesus, I quote, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself," unquote. If you do that consistently, I guarantee you a life of prosperity. But just to be sure you understand a crucial word in that statement, and there are a number of crucial words. What do we mean by loving ourselves? What do we mean by loving God? That is some questions to be answered another time. But there's another crucial word that came up in that conversation between the lawyer and Jesus. The lawyer has asked, "But who is my neighbor?" Jesus answered with the parable of the Good Samaritan. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, and these are strangers, so-called from Samaria, but a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, "Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back." Unquote. At the end of the story, Jesus asks the lawyer, "Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers?" The lawyer replies, the one who showed him mercy. Jesus says to the lawyer, go thou and do likewise. I say the same to you. We are all neighbors to each other. We are all connected. There is oneness among us. Knowing that truth and acting accordingly is the first step to prosperity. Oh, and the answer to Reverend Sonia's question about the size of the banana that John brought me. It was large. Namaste.